The next lemma that I'm going to talk about is the lemma 7, which I will call the capacity lemma. The capacity lemma states as follows. For any epsilon greater than 0, there are m minus s are linearly independent vectors denoted z1 through zm minus s in lambda. Recall that S is the rank of the free abelian group M. M is the z-span of the vectors U1 through US. And this was in lemma 3. Such that those are linearly independent vectors z1 through zm minus s in lambda is actually in the ball centered at the origin with radius epsilon under the maximum norm, intersection lambda. And now you may understand why I call this the capacity lemma. This tells you, for any small positive number, our lambda, which is the collection of all aq minus p's, will contain at least m minus 1 many are linearly independent vectors in this small neighborhood at the origin with radius epsilon. This is really good about this lambda. This shows as long as this S is small, namely as long as the rank of M is small, this lambda will have a big capacity at the origin. Namely, it could contain a lot of linearly independent vectors around the origin. And you may want to compare this lemma with our previous lemma 5, the rigidity lemma, which says any vector in lambda close to the origin will be orthogonal to the subspace generated by M, which tells you that the behavior of vectors in lambda close to the origin could be very rigid in terms of their orientation with respect to M. So it looks very interesting when you compare different properties of the set lambda. Now let us start the proof. For any given epsilon greater than 0, we will construct z1 through zm minus s successively. Suppose we have already constructed key vectors z1 through zt where t is greater or equal to 0, less than m minus s. So you can see this as our induction hypothesis. We allow t to be equal to 0 for the case when it will be impossible to find linearly independent vectors in lambda intersection the ball centered at the origin with radius epsilon. So let me still carefully write it down. So those t vectors are linearly independent over R and in this small neighborhood of 0 of lambda. Then if you look at this vector space, the R span of the 1 through the t together with u1 through us because our t here is strictly less than m minus s. This is a proper subspace of Rn, namely s plus t is less than m. So the dimension cannot be greater than m minus 1. So this tells you the orthogonal complement of V is non-trivial by linear algebra. So we can take a vector lambda from the orthogonal complement that is non-zero. And in particular, this lambda cannot be in R span of U1 through US. We do all of these just to invoke lemma 6. What we want to use is a contrapositive of lemma 6. And in particular, we need a negation of this part to get the linear independence. That is the idea that we are following here. Therefore, by lemma 6, for any epsilon 1 greater than 0, in particular, we take epsilon 1 to be equal to epsilon as above, and we take lambda and lambda as above. There exists a z sub t plus 1 in lambda such that its maximum norm is less than epsilon. With the maximum norm less than epsilon such that lambda transpose times z sub t plus 1 is non-zero. Namely, lambda is not orthogonal to zt plus 1. But by our choice of lambda, we took lambda in the orthogonal complement of V, which is spanned by z1 through zt and u1 through us. In particular, this lambda will be orthogonal to all those z1 through zt's. So lambda t zi is equal to 0 for any I from 1 to t. Now we claim that the set of t plus 1 vectors z1 through zt together with zt plus 1 are linearly independent. This should be obvious to you if you know linear algebra very well. So I will let you think about it, but I will give you a quick proof later. Indeed, if you have this linear combination, then by applying lambda transpose, we get so all the first t terms will be killed by this, and the last term will remain. So kt plus 1 times lambda t zt plus 1 is equal to 0. But this part is not 0. So kt plus 1 is equal to 0. And you look at the rest, that k1 z1 plus the kt zt is equal to 0. This implies that k1 through kt are all equal to 0. So I should add that this expression is over R, namely k1 through kt plus 1 are all real numbers. So this proves that those t plus 1 vectors are linearly independent over R. And that, together with the fact that zt plus 1 has a norm less than epsilon, as well as our induction hypothesis saying that z1 through zt are not only linearly independent, but also inside this ball of radius epsilon. So those all together gives us the result for the case t plus 1. And by mathematical induction, we can construct z1 through zm minus 1 successively. And I should emphasize that the hypothesis that t is less than m minus 1 is important, because it's going to be used to show that V is a proper subset of Rm, so that it could have a non-trivial orthogonal complement. And this finishes the proof of lemma 7.